Lecture 10, Enlightenment in the English Literature, the Age of Reason. Objectives. After the lecture, students will be able to define and explain the Age of Enlightenment, identify some of the major ideas of the Enlightenment, list Enlightenment thinkers and their contributions. Explain the impact of Enlightenment to the literature. Acquaint with the bright representatives of Enlightenment and their works. During this lecture, we are going to discuss the following questions. The first one, historical background of the Enlightenment. The second, periods of the English Enlightenment. Early Enlightenment, Daniel Defoe, Jonathan Swift. The second, Meiji Enlightenment, Henry Fielding, Tobias Smollett, Samuel Richardson. And the last one is Sentimentalism, Oliver Goldsmith, Richard Sheridan, and Robert Burns. The history of England of the second half of the 17th century and during the 18th century was marked by British colonial expansion. London became a great trading metropolis as well as administrative, political and legal center of England. Its commercial wealth helped the government become the ruling government all over the British Isles and develop contacts outside Britain. London was the center of wealth and civilization. The city became the most important district in London. Houses were not numbered because common population couldn't read. Instead of the numbers, pictures were used. The poets and the literary men attended the coffee houses to read their creations. The 18th century, dominated both by theology and science, allowed reason to emerge as a real, genuine and inspiring force. The writers of the Age of Enlightenment wanted to improve the world, but some of them hoped to do this only by teaching. Others openly protested against the social order. This period saw a remarkable rise in literature. People wrote on many subjects and made great contributions in the fields of philosophy, history, natural sciences, and the new science of political economy. Writers widely accepted those literary forms, in particular prose forms, which were understandable to the people as a whole. English literature of the period may be characterized by the following features. The first, as we have already said, the period saw the rise of the political pamphlets and essays, but the leading genre of the Enlightenment became the novel. Poetry, as the heroic age of Shakespeare, gave way to the prose age of the essayists and novelists. The prose style became clear, graceful, and polished. The second, the hero of the novel was no longer a prince, but a representative of the middle class. And the last one, literature became very instructive. Problems of good and evil were set forth. Writers tried to teach their readers what was good and what was bad from their own points of view. The literature of the Age of the Enlightenment may be divided into three periods. The development has three stages. The first, Early Enlightenment, the second, Meiji Enlightenment. The third period of Enlightenment also indicates the beginning of the sentimentalism. From the artistic point of view, these decades are characterized in poetry by the classical style. The first period of Enlightenment lasted from the Glorious Revolution till the end of the 1730s. It is characterized by classicism in poetry. The greatest followers of the classic style were Alexander Pope, the Richard Stern. Alongside with this high style, there appeared new prose literature, the essays of Steele and Edison, and the first realistic novels written by Defoe and Swift. The second period was the most mature in English literature and lasted from 1740 to 1750. It was marked by the development of the realistic social novels by Samuel Richardson, Henry Fielding, and Tobias Smollett. The third period refers to the last decades of the century. It was marked by the new trend within Enlightenment called sentimentalism. It's known by the works of Oliver Goldsmith, Lawrence Stern, and the rise of the realistic drama by Richard Sheridan. Daniel Defoe, the founder of the early bourgeoisie realistic novel, was first and foremost a journalist and in many ways the father of modern English periodicals. The Review, which he founded in 1704 and conducted until 1713, is regarded as the first English newspaper. It paved the way for the magazines The Tatler and The Spectator. Daniel Defoe was born in London in a family of non-conformists. His father, a butcher, was wealthy enough to give his son a good education. Daniel was to become a minister in a non-conformist church, but when his training was completed, he decided to engage in business as a hoister. It was his cherished desire to become wealthy, but his wish was never fulfilled. Defoe went bankrupt several times. He was always deep in debt. 30 times I was rich and poor, he used to say. The only branch of business in which he proved successful was journalism and literature. When the Protestant king William was placed on the throne, Defoe started writing pamphlets praising his policy. This was at the beginning of Defoe's literary career. In his essay on projects, Defoe anticipated the greatest public improvements of modern times. Owing to the fact that William III was supported by the Whig party, he was continually attacked by the Tories, who called him Dutch William. Some Tones attacked him in a satirical poem, The Foreigners, in which they declared that the English race should be kept pure. During the reign of Queen Anne, persecution of the dissenters began again, as in the reign of James II, Defoe wrote pamphlets in defense of the dissenters entitled The Shortest Way with the Dissenters, in which he attacked the Tones and established church. In 1719, he tried his hand at another kind of literature fiction and wrote the novel he is now best known by, The Life and Adventures of Robinson Crusoe. After the book was published, Defoe became famous and rich and was able to pay his creditors in full. Now, he wrote for four public magazines and received a regular sum of money from the government. Other novels which Defoe wrote were also very much talked about during his lifetime, but we don't hear much about them now. Defoe published The Life of Captain Singleton in 1720, The Fortunes and Misfortunes of Moll Flanders in 1721, The History of Colonel Jack in 1722, and The History of the Lady Roxana in 1724. In 1729, while at work on a book which was to be entitled The Complete English Gentleman, Defoe fell ill, and in 2 years' time he died. Robinson Crusoe's books about voyage and new discoveries were exceedingly popular in the first quarter of the 18th century. A true story that was described in one of Steele's magazines, The Englishman Attacked, attracted Defoe's attention. It was about Alexander Selkirk, a Scottish sailor who had quarreled with his captain and was put ashore on a desert island near South America, where he lived quite alone for 4 years and 4 months. In 1702, he was picked up by a passing vessel. Selkirk's story interested Defoe so much that he decided to use it for a book. However, he made his hero Robinson Crusoe spend 26 years on a desert island. Jonathan Swift was born in Dublin, but he came from an English family. He didn't know his father because he was born 7 months after his death. His mother didn't pay much attention to him, and the boy was brought up and supported by his uncle. After finishing school, he entered Trinity College in Dublin, and there he got his bachelor's degree in 1686. In 1692, Swift went to Oxford and took his Master of Arts degree. He began writing in 1680, but his first book, The Battles of Books and The Tale of a Tub, were published in 1704. Swift came in close contact with common people in Ireland. He saw the difficult conditions under which they lived. He wrote pamphlets criticizing the English colonial policy to Ireland. He became very popular among Irish people. In 1726, he wrote his masterpiece Gulliver's Travels. He was not only popular among Irish people, but in literary circles. In his novel, he satirized the evil of the existing society in the form of fictitious travels. The novel falls into four parts describing four voyages of Gulliver. After publication of this novel, the bourgeoisie critics started attempts against Swift. They accused him for his contempt and hatred to humanity and extreme pessimism. Henry Fielding came from an ancient aristocratic family, studied at Eton. At 20, he began to write for the stage, and in his first play, Love in Several Masks, he exposed the hypocrisy in London. In 1728, he entered the University of Leiden, but he didn't graduate as he couldn't pay his fees. He wrote a lot of plays. His best political comedies include A Judge in His Own Trap, and Don Quixote in England, Pasquin. In his plays, he criticized various sides of contemporary society, the English court of law, corruption of state officials, and religion. Tobias Smollett developed further the tradition of English bourgeoisie realistic novel. Walter Scott called Fielding and Smollett two fathers of English novel. They paved the way to realism of Dickens and Thackeray. Besides, Smollett's novels were very much like Swift ones. Smollett then began what he regarded as his major work, A Complete History of England, which took from 1757 to 1765. Having suffered the loss of a daughter, he went abroad with his wife, and the result was Travels Through France and Italy, 1766. He also wrote The History and Adventures of an Atom in 1769. He also visited Scotland, and this visit helped inspire his last novel, The Expedition of Humphrey Clinker, in 1771, published in the year of his death. Samuel Richardson began his literary career rather late at 50. His works continued the trend of bourgeoisie's realistic trend as well as began a new trend of sentimentalism in English literature. His novels were very popular at his time, not only in England but also in Russia. His first novel was Pamela or Virtue Rewarded in 1740. In this novel, he depicted the inner world of his characters. Pamela's character was the embodiment of middle-class virtue. The plot isn't very complicated. She was a rich lady's maid. After the lady's death, she was persecuted by her son, but she resisted all temptation, and finally the son fell in love with her and proposed to her. Thus, her virtue was rewarded. The second novel, Clarissa, or The History of a Young Lady, is a tragic story of a young lady who left her home and ran with her beloved Lovelace. Lovelace was very selfish. He tempted Clarissa, but after some time he understood that he loved her and wanted her to be his wife, but she refused. Her suffering and disappointment undermined her health and she died. Lovelace left for Italy and soon was killed at a duel by Clarissa's cousin. Oliver Goldsmith was born in Ireland in the family of a priest. He began his literary career writing a lot of essays. One of the most known was The Citizen of the World. Then he wrote comedies such as The Good-Natured Man, The Mistakes of a Knight, and a lot of poems, the most famous of which is The Deserted Village. He described those protests that took place in the village under the corrupting influence of the Industrial Revolution. Richard Sheridan developed the satirical English drama, was known also as a progressive social figure. Once he made a speech in Parliament which lasted for 6 hours. He was born in Dublin, his father was an actor, mother a writer. He was received a good education, studied at Harrow. His first comedy called The Rivals was staged in 1775, then several comedies followed, by the most popular of his works was a comedy School for Scandal in 1777. Robert Burns, the most democratic poet of the 18th century, the most famous in England and especially in Scotland. His birthday on the 25th of January is celebrated as a national holiday in Scotland. His poetry inspired many poets and was highly appreciated by readers, critics, and writers. He was born in a small village, a low way and Irishshire in 1759. His father was a poor farmer, but despite his fact, his greatest wish was to give his children, two sons, the best possible education. Later, Burns wrote a poem about his father. While they were still young, he began to teach them to read and write. When Robert was 13, he had to do most of the work of the farm. It was a hard time for Burns. He was often ill because of hard work. Rather early, at 15 or 17, he began to write. He wrote both in English and in the dialect of his own country. With tenderness, understanding, and simplicity, he depicted the new. Being a young man, he fell in love and out of love many times, but his true love was Jane. In 1786, he published a collection of his poems called Poems Chiefly in the Scottish Dialect. They were lyrical, humorous, satirical. This small volume changed his life. He became at once very popular. He was invited to Edinburgh, was accepted in various rich houses, and was welcomed as one of the wonders of the world. He was received by the elite of society, but he fell ill at easy among those people who tried to use talent and never really helped him. He became more and more popular and at the same time poor, because in 1791 he went bankrupt and had to sell his farm. It destroyed his health and he died in poverty at 37. This is the end of our lecture. Conclusion. The Enlightenment was a movement in Europe that stressed truth and reason. There are three main periods of the Enlightenment: the early period, Age of Enlightenment, and sentimentalism. In this very slide, given the questions for self-checking. Here given the glossary concerning our lecture. Here given the literature for further reading.